defend it.
Bring it in. This is going to be our game plan.
I call it the fee plan. So first, just watch.
Nice, but why did that look like it was moving?
You don't know how that happened?
No, I thought those were all like individual pictures.
So you haven't heard of fee movement before?
No.
Oh, that's when you use a series of still images to make it look like something's moving. Such as lights on a sign or things in a flipbook.
So it's like the fee phenomenon?
Yeah.
Weird.
Alright, so for the big game on Thursday, we're gonna have you run a lap around the track. Make sure you stay in your lane though.
How am I supposed to stay in my lane when it looks like it comes together towards the end?
Well, actually it doesn't. Like, the lane has two parallel lines, which means that they're lines that run side by side and they're straight, but they never end up actually touching each other. And because of the linear perspective, even though like they're coming together and if B is the end of the track, they're actually not. So your lane's not getting smaller, it just looks like it.
Whoa, guys, when I was running past you, Shelby looked more blurry but closer to me, and Laurel looked clearer but farther away.
That must be because of the motion parallax, which shows that from your perspective, when someone is closer to you, they appear blurry because they're moving faster, and when someone's farther away, the image seems clearer and sharper because they're farther away from you.
I don't think I get it.
I think I do, though. So when you're driving in a car and you look out the window, all those like small little trees close by the road look like they're going so fast, even though your car is the one that's going so fast and the trees are standing still. But if you were to pass like a house, like far away in the distance, it wouldn't look like the house was like running super fast like the trees looked. You'd be moving. Both objects are standing still, but the one that's further away appears like it's going a lot slower than the one that's right next to you.
That makes sense.
All right, now that we've warmed up on the track, let's get some practice in the paint. Psych right. On three. 1, 2, 3, Psych!
Yeah, but you've done that before, so I thought I was just going to get knocked over anyway.
Coach Olson.
Rayne's perception of Laurel pushing him down was guided by past experiences and events through the top-down theory.
Rayne!
Using multiple pieces of information from Laurel, Rayne was able to see the whole pattern and recognize that Laurel was going to charge him using the bottom-up theory.
Rayne, pass!
I'm not Rayne, I'm clearly Laurel.
Coach! I couldn't even recognize her. Why can't I recognize her? Do I have a visual problem?
You don't have a visual problem. What you have is propagnosia. There's no known cure or cause, but it's the inability to recognize faces.
What?
I'm gonna be Rayne forever now.
Oh no.
Coach, this jersey is so itchy. Is it ever gonna stop being itchy?
Yes, actually Rayne, because of sensory adaptation, the sensory receptors in your skin will stop sending non-essential information to the part of your brain that picks up your senses, known as the thalamus.
That's a great plan, Summer.
I know.
Shelby was able to know the plan because of a process called telepathy, which is where you can communicate with other people through your minds, yet it hasn't been scientifically proven.
Yo, Coach, I'm positive. I'm gonna score mad threes at the game on Thursday.
You cannot be positive because precognition, the ability to see into the future, has not been proven yet. I am so excited for this game.
Me too. I can't wait to play. Wait a minute. Do you hear the pregame music? It's playing like quietly in the distance.
No, I don't hear Frosty the Snowman.
Oh, it must be below your absolute threshold for hearing.
What's that?
Your absolute threshold is the minimum amount of sound you can hear. So if it's below your absolute threshold, you can't hear it. It happens about 50% of the time, but it's different for each person, which is why I can hear it right now, and you can, I guess. Something smells in here. It must be a sock.
I don't know what you're talking about. I don't smell anything.
You don't smell anything? It must be below your absolute threshold.
What's that?
Your absolute threshold for smelling is the smallest amount of fragrance that your nose can detect, about 50% of the time.
It varies from person to person, which is why sometimes you can smell really small things, and other times you can't.
All right, come on, Summer. You gotta get those gains for the game on Thursday. All right, when I tap your shoulder, stop, okay?
Yep.
Summer, why are you still going? I tapped your shoulder.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did. You didn't feel that?
Nope.
Well, what's going on here?
Well, I've been taking some notes in the corner, and from what I can conclude, that's below her absolute threshold.
What's that?
The absolute threshold is any physical touch that she can't feel. So, like a tap on the shoulder that's too light, your receptors on your skin will not sense it. It's below your absolute threshold. It happens about 50% of the time, and it varies from person to person. So someone might feel this tap, and someone might not. All right, everyone. So before the big game on Thursday, you're going to do some sprints. So go run all the way down, touch the letter I, and then run back to me, okay?
I don't see a letter I down there.
Yeah, I don't see it either.
That letter I over there? You don't see that?
No.
Oh, well, that must be below your absolute threshold. So what that means is it's the smallest amount of stimulus or, like, objects that you can see and, like, your eye can pick up. So I can see the letter I. And that's because my absolute threshold is probably lower than yours. You guys can't see it, so it's part of your subliminal stimulus, which means anything that you just wouldn't notice. The closer you get to it, you'd probably be able to see it. So your absolute threshold would be a little bit closer to it. But you don't see it right now, and that's because we're different. It varies from person to person, and you can't detect it all the time. So it, also, you can only detect it about 50%.
Gotta stay hydrated for that game on Thursday.
This tastes really salty.
Really?
Wait. Yeah.
Let me try it. I don't taste any salt.
Hmm. Well, maybe that's because Rayne's absolute threshold for taste is lower than yours. So, basically, what that means is all the particles that are in your water that may make it taste salty to you, Rayne can't taste. It's about 50% of the time the smallest amount of particles that you can taste, diluted in water or just in normal foods. But it varies from person to person, which is why Rayne doesn't taste the salty water.
Game on Thursday, number 5 on the other team. I hate her.
Oh my god, me too. Schmummer Schmurf Matt?
I think her name's Schmelby Schmulchen.
No, you know who we're thinking of? It's Schmerk Schmin Schmajan.
You know what? You're right. Can't stand her.
She's the worst. I wish she would... We should just, like, kill her.
Honestly, I agree.
Oh my god, she's the worst.
Oh, hey, Summer. That was a pretty good game out there.
Thanks.
Do you know what happened to the number 5 player on the other team?
No.
Oh, really? Because I saw you kill her.
What are you talking about?
Well, you see, I'm a clairvoyant, which means I can see things and hear things without having to be there, almost like an illusion. And I saw you kill number 5.
I don't think you did, because clairvoyancy has never been proven, so that won't hold up in court.
Alright, well... Alright, who here remembers the legendary game of the Gestalt Psychologist versus the Structuralist? Really? Well, okay, in the game, the Structuralists actually...
Oh, wait, I think I remember it now. It's when the Structuralists add together thousands of sensations in order to create perceptions.
Yes.
And the Gestalt Psychologists believe that our brain followed a set of rules to organize information into perceptions.
Exactly. So, in the game, the Gestalt Psychologists... One, because they valued teamwork over working as individual parts. And they ended up like coining the term, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. And their team worked together to get the dub. And that term is still active today. We need to use this in our game on Thursday.
Coach, my eyes are really drawn to the black lines on the ball.
Well, Shelby, that's because your eyes prefer to follow the continuous path, in other words, the path of continuity, rather than following this sharp turn here, because it's just more preferable.
Gotcha.
Summer, what are you doing?
Summer's actually just organizing all these pieces of stimuli or things by their similarities. So her brain is telling her that all the softballs are about the same size, the same shape, same texture, or whatever. So they're putting them together because they're all similar. Same thing with the basketballs. They all look the same, they're about the same size. So your brain tells you they should be grouped together. These are all the similarity principle. So even though they are in the same group of balls, you're able to distinguish between different sizes and colors and things of that nature, and then be able to separate them. So it makes more sense to you.
All right, Summer, could you grab those four balls in the top left of the rack and the two in the top right, please?
Why don't you just say, grab those six balls?
Well, it's the same thing, but I was using the proximity rule. Do you know what that is?
Nope.
Oh, okay. Well, the proximity rule is when you have groups of close together objects, for example, these four balls that are close in the top left and the two that are close in the top right, and you group them together as one thing instead of saying there's six on the top rack. It's the same thing.
Makes sense.
All right, now grab those balls, Summer.
Hey, Coach, is it just me, or when I look at the hoop, I see the circle of it, and then I see the rectangle of the backboard?
Well, yeah, that's because of the simplicity rule.
What's that?
It's when you see a complex figure, such as this circle attached to that rectangle on the bottom, and you distinguish the two parts to make two separate things instead of combining it to make one complex figure.
Makes sense.
All right, Summer and Laurel, so you're going to need to be in this type of pattern on the court, okay?
That kind of looks like a triangle.
It does kind of look like a triangle. In fact, it is a passing triangle. You can see the triangle even though the lines weren't there initially because of the closure rule, which means that you put together all the missing puzzle pieces because your brain wants to see a whole shape, not just little parts of a picture.
Oh, Shelby, that kind of reminds me of subjective contours.
Oh, what's that?
That's when you see a shape such as this. And it appears as if there's a triangle in the foreground of the picture. However, there's no triangle actually there, but your mind sees a triangle.
So it's like a visual illusion that shows you the edge even though there's no physical mark?
Exactly.
Oh, okay.
Has nothing to do with basketball, but I thought I should let you know.
Sounds good.
Shelby, what are you doing?
I'm feeling all the good vibes on this court, Coach. I know we're going to win on Thursday. I can just sense it.
You're using ESP?
Mm-hmm.
So you're using extrasensory perception, which is when you gather information beyond your five senses?
Yeah.
Well, that hasn't been scientifically proven yet, so I don't know what you're doing.
Well, some people think that it's a thing.
All right, Rayne, so pay attention here. This is what you're going to look like on the court.
Yeah.
Ready?
You should tell him that. Like,
what the heck is that?
It's just a couple different plays I've been thinking of. Actually, you know what this looks like? The Mueller-Lyer illusion.
What's that?
Well, see these two lines in the middle right here?
Yeah.
They're the exact same size, but they don't look
no,
it, right?
Not.
No, they are. I'm telling you. But because of the fins facing outward on this one and the fins facing inward on this one, your brain is telling you that this one is longer. Mueller-Lyer illusion has been looked at for years extensively, and it's just one of those weird phenomenons and illusions that your brain can't really sort out. But these lines are the same length.
I really don't believe you.
Measure them.
Oh,
see?
Oh, my God.
Isn't that crazy?
What the heck?
All right. Back to the game plan.
All right.
Shelby, what are you doing?
Just trying to get some studying in before practice. Right now, I'm looking at my AP Psych work because we have this huge test on illusions and all these like weird theories and stuff. But this one in particular is super crazy. It's the Ponzo illusion. So in my book, you can see this picture, and the top bar appears to be much longer than the bottom black bar. But if you were to measure it, you would see that they're the exact same size, which is kind of weird. But just in your brain, when you see things that are the same size, but one is further away, your mind automatically tells you that it's larger. But this picture is clearly disputing that. It's a super weird theory to think about. I'm also learning about the Ames room, which is so weird. The picture, like, the boy appears smaller than the girl, even though they're the same height. And it's just because this person was looking through at this room through a little peephole, and your brain is telling you, like, normal dimensions of a room. Like, a room is normally rectangular, you know, things of that nature. But this room is made weirdly. So one kid, like, the corners are a lot longer and further away. So this kid is standing in a spot that's actually, like, considerably further away from you. So that's why he looks smaller. And you just can't tell because your brain is telling you they're in a normal size room.
So our perception of size can be affected by our depth cues, like what you're telling me about with monocular and binocular cues?
Yeah, exactly.
I get it.
The Super Bowl's happening, Rayne.
Oh, wow. The Super Bowl is actually an example of distal stimuli, which is an event in the world around you.
Oh, well, I can't. I'm so excited because we're going to eat so much food, watch the game, probably listen to the commentators. It's going to be a blast.
Yeah, exactly. And to bring it up, that's actually proximal stimuli because it's things that can actually reach your senses, such as hearing something, seeing something, or feeling something, or eating something.
Gotcha.
Ow, coach, another player just elbowed me in the eye. I have to wear this stupid eye patch now.
Oh, that sucks, because now you won't be able to use your binocular cues, which allows you to use both of your eyes to perceive things in the environment. You're going to have to use only a monocular cue now, which uses one of your eyes to perceive how things are in the environment.
Ah, this sucks.
Hey, coach, when we shine the light on this ball, parts of it look illuminated.
What are you guys doing shining a flashlight on the ball?
We just got bored, yeah. Okay? Just...
Well, I might as well explain to you the whole monocular cue of light and shadow. That's when the object closest to you, or in this case, the front of the ball, that's the closest part of the ball to the light, and that close part is going to be lit up more than these left and right sides and top and bottom, because these sides are farther away from the light source. And that's how you know that this ball goes back into a sphere rather than a circle.
All right, so guys, I just want to kind of give you an overview of what we're going to be doing when we start our practices. So if you look at this court, we're going to be running suicides at the beginning of every practice. So we're going to run from this baseline to this line, which I labeled number one, which is the shortest line. And then we're going to run back to the baseline. And then we're going to be running to number two at half court, which is the second shortest line. And then we're going to run back to the baseline. And then we're going to run to line three, which is the second tallest line. And then we're going to run back to the baseline. And then run to the opposite baseline, which is the tallest line. Coach, and then...
Coach, when you're talking about lines, you're talking about, like, the length, right?
No. I'm talking about height in plane. Do you know what I'm talking about?
No.
Okay, well, height in plane is actually a monocular cue for depth. And that's when you're looking at a flat plane, and things that appear taller in your line of sight, you know they are farther in the distance if they're in the same plane. You get it now?
Yeah.
Okay, so you know number four is the farthest away because it's the tallest in the plane when you're looking at it. And number three is the second tallest, so it's not as far away as number four. All right.
Got it.
All right, guys, let's get some practice in. Oh wait, this ball's flat, but we could use that one, but that one's too small.
Actually, they're the same size. Because of relative size, two objects that are the same size will appear smaller or larger depending on the distance from your eyes. So you can use that ball to play.
Whoa. You're right, it is the same size.
Coach, I'm having a lot of trouble seeing the right side of this ball. It's almost like that view is like completely cut off.
Well, that's because you can't use the binocular cue of retinal disparity, which is when an object is close to you, both of your eyes see a slightly different version of the image so that your brain can make an entire image. But when it's farther away from you, your eyes can have more range of the entire image so that your brain can process what's really there.
So the farther away an object, the smaller the retinal disparity, and the closer it is, the larger the retinal disparity?
Yes.
And that just has to do with the location of my eyes?
Yeah.
Oh, gotcha.
Go. Freeze. All right, who's closer to the camera?
Summer.
All right, Summer is close. You can tell Summer is closer to the camera because of the monocular depth perception of inner position, which shows that Summer is closer because she is overlapping Shelby. And you can tell that Rayne is farther away because he is being overlapped by Summer and Shelby.
This ball's all frayed and torn. It looks horrible. All the sharp details make it look really terrible. Can I use that ball over there? It looks perfect.
Here.
This one's just as bad. Oh my gosh, it's all torn up. Why couldn't I see that before?
Actually, that's because of the monocular cue of texture and gradient, which shows that an object that's closer and has more detail will appear closer than an object that is farther away that has less detail.
So the further away it is, it looks more dull, and the closer it is, it's sharp?
Yes.
Gotcha.
Coach!
Yeah, what happened?
I think I have a concussion.
Oh my gosh, what happened?
A ball hit me in the head.
All right, we should test your convergence.
Okay, what's that?
That's when an object approaches your face, and as it approaches your face, your eyes are pulled together by the muscles in your head, which are almost like strings. So as the strings pull your eyes in, you know that the object is getting closer to your face, and as the strings pull your eyes out, then you know that an object is getting farther away.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so we should test your convergence.
Okay.
So just follow my finger, keep your eye right here. All right, you ready?
Yep.
Notice how her eyes are getting closer to her face as my finger gets closer and farther away. Okay, your convergence is definitely fine. I think you're gonna be all right. I don't think you have a concussion. All
right,
you're
great.
Gonna be good. All right, great. Let's get back out there.
Okay.
All right, guys, come on in here for a minute. I wanna talk to you. Okay, so what are some rules of basketball?
You can't travel, which is where you can't run around with the ball without dribbling.
All right.
You can't double dribble when you dribble, pick up the ball, and then try to dribble again.
All right, and so what's similar about these rules? They remain constant all the time, just like your perception. They never really change. This is the perceptual constancy theory. Okay, so Laurel, go run over there really quickly. So Rayne, even though Laurel is super far away right now, and the image that's displayed on your retina is telling you that she's really small, you know that she's not that small because her size doesn't change. So that's the size constancy idea, okay? Even though she's far away, you still know that she didn't shrink at all.
Yeah.
And she gets far away, and when she comes closer, you know that she's not grown. So when any object move or run away or come back, their size doesn't change, so your body and your mind tells you that.
Okay.
All right, Rayne. So in the same way that basketball rules are consistent, and even your size constancy are consistent, your perceptual constancies are always the same. That pertains to size, color, brightness, and also shape. So as you go around the three-point line, the backboard isn't, to your eyes, is not always in a rectangle. Your retina sees a parallelogram and constantly sees it moving, just like a lot of shapes you see in the real world.
Okay.
But your brain tells you that it's still a rectangle no matter what. So even though your retina is seeing a different shape as you move around, and with most shapes in the world, your brain is able to sort out these images and tell you the actual shape, which is a rectangle. Guys, so the pregame music is on, okay?
I can't hear it.
You can't hear it at all?
No.
It's clearly playing. Can you hear it?
Yeah.
It must be subliminal stimulus for you, which is type of stimulus that you can't hear or detect or see. So it's below your absolute threshold. That's weird. I'll turn it up a little bit, though. Can you hear it now?
Can you turn it up a little bit more?
How's that?
You didn't turn it up at all.
You couldn't tell?
No.
Could you tell?
No.
How now?
Yeah, I know.
Oh, so that must be your just noticeable difference, which is the smallest increase or decrease in stimulus that you're able to detect about 50% of the time. So, for example, if you're listening to a really, really loud song and I only put it up about 1 or 2, you're not going to really notice it. But if I put it up even more, 5 or 10 decibels, it's going to be hurting so much, it's going to be so loud, you're going to understand that it just got louder. So that's a really high intensity, so it takes a lot more to make you notice that just noticeable difference. Something that's playing really quietly, you're not going to need as much of a difference in intensity or stimulus because it's such a small intensity already. So if the music was playing really quietly and I just turned it up 1, you can hear that just noticeable difference in your stimulus. You can detect it though only about 50% of the time, so it varies from person to person and from situation to situation.
Man, coach, I'm so tired from that practice. Why can't I just grab that ball without even moving? Because I really don't want to move over there and grab the ball.
Well, it's too bad you can't use psychokinesis, the ability to move objects with just your mental power and not your 5 senses, because it hasn't been scientifically proven yet.
You're telling me I can get that ball with just my mind?
No, you can't.
I think I can. Yeah, coach. What did I just do?
It still hasn't been proven yet.
Yeah.
Coach, when I'm looking at the back of the rim, everything else around the backboard appears blurry.
Well, that's because when you're organizing stimuli or things that you're seeing, you use the figure ground rule a lot of times. So what you're focusing on is the rim and the backboard. That's your main thing. And they stand out against the background, which is the trees and even just the driveway and the cars. You stop noticing them. Their details are more dull. And the rim and the backboard, they stick out. That's what you want to focus on. And that's what your brain tells you is the focus.
Okay.
Right. Better luck next time. All right, guys. So when you're choosing a basketball team, you want to make sure that you think about all the options. So you might choose Rayne in this scenario because, first of all, height is a huge advantage when you're playing basketball, and Summer's clearly shorter. And also, he's holding the ball a little bit more professionally than Summer is. It's not even in her hands, which is what you use for basketball. But all these opinions that I'm making right now and ideas that I'm coming up with are based on my perceptual sets, which is just information that I already have because of personal experience, social experience, like whether I live in America or England or anywhere else in the world, and also cultural. So, you know, oftentimes your perception is changed based on where you live. So all these things amount together to change my perception and give me a better idea of how I make decisions and overall just change the way I look at things.
Okay, we need to get something straight here, guys. So in basketball, there's one thing that you really need to play, depth perception. So depth perception is the ability for your brain to interpret what your eyes see to create a third dimension, because your eyes only see things in two dimensions, such as height and width. But when your brain processes the information that comes from your eyes, it produces a third dimension called depth, which allows you to see how far things away are and how far things go back in space. And you need that in basketball, such as shooting a free throw, or to see that the ball isn't a circle, it's a sphere.
Okay, so when I'm looking at this basketball, my eyes are seeing it as if it was drawn on a piece of paper in 2D, and then my brain tells me that it's 3D and it's actually round and not flat like a piece of paper?
Yeah.
Okay. On the end game, you wanted to make sure that you were playing great defense and you wanted to play really great offense. And that's awesome. But while you were doing all that, you missed things that were going on the court. And that's through inattentional blindness. When a lot of things are going on around you and maybe you're focusing on one key detail, so you miss other things that are apparent and oftentimes a little bit weird. They completely go over the top of your head. Your subconscious notices them, but you don't. And the difference between your conscious and your subconscious is whether or not you notice them. So you're gonna notice your conscience is things like, I'm talking to you right now. You understand that I'm talking to you. You know what I'm saying. You're thinking about it. But your subconscious maybe is thinking about the fact that a bird just flew by my head, or the wind is rustling the trees. Things that aren't necessarily popping up as you are thinking, but your body is still recognizing them, especially your brain.
All right.
Ready?
I'm rolling.
Get it,
Mom. Wait, hold on. We gotta let him go. Carl, get out. We're filming. Go away. We're filming.
All right. You're good.
Go away. I can see you.
Stop.
We don't All
right.
Even know what we're doing.
You're good, Shelby.
Okay. I'm good.
Man, I wish I could grab that ball over there.
Gotta stay hydrated for that game on Thursday.
Cold night.
Shelby, what are you doing right now?
Just
I thought about it too much. Okay.
I'm still recording.
Okay. That's a good blooper. I think, like, panicked a little bit. Okay. Go ahead. Alright. Shelby, what are you doing right now?
I can tell when I was saying that you're still laughing.
I wasn't ready. I couldn't reel it in. Okay.
Okay.
It's not that funny. I can say this. Okay.
Did I laugh?
I'm ready now.
Okay.
I'll just record you saying that and put
yeah,
it
just
the
say
video.
Your line now. Okay, what, so just be quiet for a second and then just say your line after.
Our perceptions of size can be distorted by changing depth cues, like monocular and binocular.
So our perception of size can be
what by depth cues? Can be distorted.
Distorted, okay. I'm sorry.
Or can be like affected. All right, just say affected, because it's distorted straight from the book.
Okay. Sorry, I need to think about it. I don't know why I can't say this.
It's okay.
So our perception of size can be affected by depth cues.
Yeah, by changing depth cues. So like all the things you talked about. So all the things you were telling me about with binocular and monocular depth cues. You can say that to me.
Alright, I hope I can say. Why is this tripping me up so bad?
I don't know, but you got this. This is gonna be okay.
Alright, just take a pause and then just go at it.
Coach, there's air leaking from this ball.
Where's the leak?
I don't know where the leak is. <That's weird. laughs> Okay. No.
Coach, this jersey is so itchy. Is it ever going to stop being itchy?
Yes, Rayne. Because of sensory adaptation, the sensory muscles in... or the sensory... Fuck.